This is a production of Cornell University.
So good morning, everybody. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. I'm going to dive right in because I want to keep on time. And my presentation today will first attempt to scare the bejesus out of you. That's the first stage. And then the second stage is to educate you. Okay, so we're talking about ticks. And this is phase one, scare the bejesus out of you. So this figure represents tick-borne disease in the United States. And every single dot on this map represents a reported incidence of a tick-borne disease. Now, you can see for some parts of New York, where I come from, the Hudson Valley, you can't even distinguish the dots. There are multiple diseases that are present, and they are reported throughout all the counties in the lower Hudson Valley. This diagram is from 2016, so this has certainly changed. You can still hear me now? Okay, great. So this has certainly changed. But as you can see, in New York State, we have a great risk of being exposed to multiple tick-borne diseases. And in addition to tick-borne disease, there's also things that will really make your life not great. First, Lone Star tick spreads new disease and food allergens. Okay, now when this tick feeds on you, it injects its saliva, and your body thinks that the saliva is something that's attacking you. And a property similar in that saliva can be found in red meat. So the next time you go to eat a hamburger, your body reacts as if it's being attacked. This is a red meat allergen that can actually cause serious health effects if you are exposed to this tick. So definitely something that we'd like to avoid. There's also paralysis that can occur from tick bites. Certain species and sexes of ticks will cause this ascending paralysis that starts in your feet and moves up to your body. This can lead to death if some of your body systems shut down. Now, the fix for this is really easy. You just remove the tick and the symptoms go away. But if you haven't recognized that you've been attacked by a tick, then this can be a really serious situation. And as we look closer and closer at ticks and tick-borne diseases, we find new things. So since there's been such an emphasis on ticks, they've been identifying new pathogens, new strains of known pathogens, as well as new organisms. Now, one of the greatest complications to ticks and tick-borne diseases is the fact that there are numerous misconceptions out there about how to treat yourself to protect ticks, protect yourself against ticks, and how to remove ticks. One of the things that we'll talk about today is identification, and I love seeing posts like this on social media. This person on Facebook has this critter that was crawling around on her skin. Help, what is this bug, tick, bite, or something? And then everyone chimes in, because everyone out there in Facebook land is a tick expert, obviously. Tick, I believe, looks like a tick. Don't let them dig in. Ticks actually don't dig into your body at all. She thinks it's ticks too. Tick, this person's clearly an expert. Yep, that's the long-legged tick. There's no such thing as a long-legged tick, but that's okay. Looks like a tick to me. Well, actually, this is a mite. It's not even a tick, even though all of these people said it's a tick. So now she's going to freak out, go to the doctor, do all kinds of crazy things, not actually a tick. Okay, so we have misconceptions about identification. How to remove them? Removing it with peppermint oil. Yes, douse your body in peppermint oil. Use a match. Use the tick twisting. Use this tick twister. None of these techniques have actually been proven to be safe and effective for tick removal. And I will mention to you the one safe and effective technique for tick removal. It's none of these. So if you're already doing this, we'll change that behavior today. So my objectives for this hour are to help you avoid ticks and tick-borne diseases. If we don't interact with these organisms, then we don't have to worry about the tick-borne diseases that they carry. Learn how to survey for ticks and understand options and limitations for tick management. Okay, so we will start with identification, because as I said, this is the most important step in determining a management plan. Okay, so which one of these, right or left, is the tick? Left. Okay, I did hear some confusion here. So the one on the left is a tick. How do you know? Yes? Eight legs. Okay, if you can count to eight, you can tell a tick from an insect, in most cases. Okay, the adult ticks will have 8 legs. Now, does anybody know what this thing is? Bed bug. Excellent. Now, if you are a human being in 2019, it's a good idea to know what a bed bug looks like, because they can be anywhere. They can be in public places where people congregate, they can be in hotels, movie theaters, this classroom, okay, anywhere. You want to know what this thing looks like, and you want to know where to find it, okay? Now, the reason that I have these two organisms next to each other is that this tick is actually the brown dog tick. And the brown dog tick can complete its entire life cycle in your bedroom. They're brought into homes on pets that stay at a kennel. They come inside and they can reproduce in the cracks and crevices along the baseboards of your home. Okay? So now, as a homeowner, you might find hundreds of these things biting you and your pets, and you might think, oh my God, I have bed bugs. I have to treat this place for bed bugs, when in fact you have ticks. So identification is really important. Okay, so now in this vial, there are several different species of ticks. And you may be thinking to yourself, how on earth am I going to differentiate between these different ticks? And why does it even matter? A tick is a tick, right? It matters because the different tick species actually transmit different pathogens. The one and only tick that can transmit Lyme disease is this tick right here, the black-legged tick. No other tick species is transmitting Lyme disease, okay? And the same for these other pathogens. Anaplasmosis, babesiosis, and powassan are all transmitted by the black-legged tick. Okay, so we want to be able to differentiate between these three key species. Fortunately, Tick Encounter Resource Center, which is produced by the University of Rhode Island, has a really handy resource for identifying ticks, and they make it very simple. Many of you might have picked up our identification card, but this site is terrific as well. They break it down by looking at the mouth parts and the scutum pattern. So even with no magnification, I can pick up a tick and know what species it is. Because if it has long mouth parts and a round scutum, this section right behind the head, then it's a black-legged tick. It doesn't matter if that tick is unfed or fully engorged, it's still going to have that round pattern. Okay, and these are all females, adult females, which are the ones that tend to attach for long periods of time. The one that has a triangular shaped scutum and long mouth parts is the Lone Star tick, and then the American dog tick has short mouth parts and a marbled pattern. So really easy to differentiate between those three, even with little magnification. If you're uncomfortable making that sort of diagnosis and determining which tick you've found, there are a number of resources that you can utilize, some right here on campus. So the Insect Diagnostic Lab will identify samples. I'm not sure what the arrangement is here on campus, if it's less than $25 or not. Cooperative extension offices in other counties if you come from a different county. And then, of course, using tick identification, Tick Encounter Resource Center, or Identify Us. Maybe there's someone within the program that wants to get a feel for ticks and could be your program specialist for identification. So since we're most concerned about this one particular species of tick, I'm going to talk a little bit about just the black-legged tick. Okay, this tick is a blood-feeding ectoparasite. This means that it spends most of its time out in the environment and then finds a host and feeds on their blood, on the outside of their body. They are an ambush predator with questing behavior. Now this picture that you see right here with the tick with its little front legs out like this, that is questing behavior. The only way, or the main way, that you are going to encounter this organism is if you actually walk into it. There's no other way that you're going to pick up a tick unless you walk into it. Now, maybe if your pet comes home, is laying on the bed next to you, and you were just out for a hike, and the tick falls off of them, maybe. But more than likely, this is how we're exposed to ticks. They do not jump, they're not dropping from trees, and thank goodness they do not fly, because I couldn't imagine these things coming to your window at night looking for a blood meal. Okay? This tick in particular tends to do this questing behavior on vegetation that is your knee height and below. Okay, so that's the type of environment where you're going to find them. And they have a high humidity requirement, so they're not going to be found really out in the open areas of a lawn. This tick is important because it vectors Lyme disease. This is the number one vector-borne disease in the United States. Okay? Each year, about 30,000 cases are reported, but based on the analysis of statistics with this disease, they think that we're only getting 10% of that of those diagnostics. So it's estimated that there are over 300,000 cases per year of Lyme disease. It's caused by a bacteria that is transmitted when the tick bites and feeds on you, and it could take days to weeks before those symptoms show up. So it's not an immediate transfer of that pathogen and you immediately see those symptoms. It can be treated if diagnosed on time with antibiotics. So many people in this room perhaps may have had Lyme disease and have been treated. And actually, can I see a show of hands? How many people have had Lyme disease? Okay, so not as many as I expected. But it is treatable. Now, I will say that there is a lot of controversy with the diagnosis of Lyme disease. There's some estimates that only 50%, that the test is only 50% accurate. There are some questions about treatment if you haven't identified it right away. And there's a lot of issues with insurance coverage and the financing of Lyme disease treatment. So this is all a big mess, but fortunately for me, it's not something I have to deal with because I'm just telling you to avoid the ticks and avoid all of these issues, okay? So regional cases of Lyme disease continue to rise. And you guys are the winners. Congratulations. Okay? From 2012 to 2017, you had the highest increase in the percentage of Lyme disease cases in the Finger Lakes region. Okay? Now, in some areas, for example, Region 8, where there's only an 8% increase or 18% increase, part of this could be the long history of Lyme disease in that area, but part of it could just be doctors are not reporting Lyme disease cases and just treating it because they're so familiar with this disease in that area. But as we move further west into New York, we're seeing more and more cases of Lyme disease than have been previously seen. Across the country, when we look at who is getting Lyme disease, there is one group that stands out as being at the greatest risk. And this is children, especially boys, 5 to 9 years old. So certainly not on college campus are we seeing this high rate of Lyme disease, but for children, that's the group that we are most concerned with. So all of this education is something that we should be bringing home to our families to talk about the risks of ticks and tick-borne disease, especially Lyme. Okay, so we're going to, throughout this presentation, we're going to do some true and false. So here's my first question to you. Do deer sustain Lyme disease? True or false? False. Excellent. So some people have heard this message. Many people associate Lyme disease with deer. They think that deer are intricately connected with the transmission of Lyme disease, when in fact the deer play almost zero role in the transmission and maintenance of Lyme disease. Instead, it's the small mammals, such as this critter, the white-footed mouse. And if you look closely at this animal, you can see all the ticks that are attached to its ear. Okay? These ticks will feed on small mammals and acquire the pathogens. That's the main reservoir of these pathogens, is the small mammals. They feed on them, they acquire the pathogens, and then they have them for life and can transmit them to any other organism. And here's the approximate life cycle of that. So for most diseases, okay, the larvae, which is this small version of tick, and this is why I said that almost all ticks have 8 legs, but the larval ticks that are about the size of a grain of sand have only 6 legs. Biology makes things confusing for us sometimes. So we have this larval stage. They, for the most part, are not infected with any pathogens. They feed on an organism that was previously infected with, let's say, Lyme disease for this example. Then When they molt and grow into this nymphal stage, they are infective and can then transmit the pathogen to the next set of hosts. They molt again, they become adult female on the left, adult male here on the right, and they too can transmit to the next set of hosts. Now these organisms here, deer, dog, people, the larger mammals that get fed upon by this adult stage are what we call dead-end hosts. Because after the tick transmit the pathogen to us, ticks really can't pick up the pathogen from these hosts. So the transmission cycle stops there, okay? And for the most part, with most pathogens, when the female reproduces, those pathogens are not transmitted to the eggs. So that's how we start the cycle back over again.
So when the tick gives us the disease, then is it rid of it at that point? Like it's gone from its system?
No, good question.
Or it keeps it and then it keeps infecting more humans or large animals?
Great question. So in this life cycle, this tick is only feeding one time on here, only feeding one time here, and only feeding once here. They're not feeding on multiple hosts like a mosquito would that would bite multiple hosts looking for multiple meals. They're feeding once, and then that's pretty much it for them. So they'll transmit to us and then reproduce and then die. Yep. So deer, the role that they do play is that they're a reproductive host of ticks. It's estimated that they host about 90% of all adult ticks. And you can see here, these are Lone Star ticks, but just look at how loaded those ears are with ticks. You can see some on other areas where there's less fur. Okay? Every year it's estimated that a single deer can produce 500,000 ticks. This is all estimated based on the number of ticks that have been found on some of these animals. And they are really important long-distance dispersers of ticks. We know that deer have a wide host range, and so they can move long distances and bring ticks to new areas where they were not previously found. So, another question for you. Ticks are only active spring to fall. Oh, yes, definitely false. I was hoping for a more resound answer, like false. Ticks can be active any time the temperature is above freezing. And in wintertime, even if the ambient temperature is not above freezing, but the sun is beating the ground on a patch of leaf litter, if that temperature is above freezing, ticks can be active. So we can find ticks any time of year. You can see here, this is a female tick that has a full belly that just fed on something, dropped off into the snow, okay? So these ticks can be active any time of year. There's no time of year when you shouldn't be thinking about ticks. Now, our risk of Lyme disease, however, is seasonal. Sorry about this, it got moved around a little bit. The nymphal tick is about the size of a poppy seed. That's pretty small. And they are somewhat difficult to find when they are attaching to our bodies because of that small size. In addition, they're active early in the spring when we may not be thinking about the tick season. So this is why most cases of Lyme disease are reported in late spring to early summer, because people have been exposed to that nymphal tick this time of year. They previously had May designated as Lyme Disease Awareness Month. Now there's some talk of making it in April, because even by this point, ticks are so active that we could pick up a tick and tick-borne disease by May. So we may be missing that window. Okay, so I've talked about the black-legged tick, but let's think about all the different tick species. If we looked at this figure, where would you think that the ticks are likely to be found? Tall grass, right? Okay, anywhere else? In the woods, right? We definitely, for the black-legged tick, their preference is to be in the woods. Unfortunately, just like ticks are active year-round, so there's no time of year when we don't have to worry about them, there's no place where we don't have to worry about ticks. The different species that are present in New York State and even this part of the world can be found in any of these three habitats. So our Lone Star tick, the one on the left there, can be found prefers the woods, then the edge, but then can also be found in the turf. The American dog tick loves the turf. That's like one. That's their main place. They love hanging out in turf where it's a little bit drier and a little bit warmer. And then the black-legged tick, of course, is in the woods and the forest. So no matter where you go, you could be exposed to one of these ticks. Sorry to be the bearer of more bad news. We can monitor for ticks to determine what our risk is in a specific area. And this is very scientific, very complex, okay? I don't know if any of you are ready for this level of scientific rigor here, but this is a tick drag in all its glory, a piece of fabric, okay? And the way that we monitor for ticks is we walk through that area where a tick is, where we expect ticks to find, dragging this behind us, and then you pick it up and you look for ticks. Do you guys think you could do that? seems complicated. But it's very simple, and it's a standard, when we do it in a standard scientific way, it's a very effective technique. It works because these ticks have that questing behavior where they're just waiting there for us to walk by. So they detect us, they detect our carbon dioxide, our heat, and the other cues that tell the tick that a host is nearby, and they'll grab on to that drag cloth. Now, we can collect some information using these tick drags. We can collect the ticks that we find using the appropriate pair of tweezers and then preserve them in a bottle of alcohol. This is a very satisfying part of the process because you get to watch them squirm and die in that alcohol, and it's one less tick in the population. It also, there's some evidence that doing these tick drags can reduce the numbers of ticks that are in that area. If you're constantly dragging in an area, you're picking up those ticks, perhaps the reproductive females. If you're doing this in a scientific manner, we want to record important information like where did you collect them, what time of day, what time of year, and the number. And remember that as you're doing this surveillance, you too are exposed to ticks, so you should be checking yourself as well. Now, when it comes to applying this for useful purposes, these areas where you find ticks, those are going to be your target areas for management practices. A lot of the mistakes that I see with the contracted pest management industry for residential situations is that they will not do any surveillance but then apply for tick management. You haven't identified your target pest, you don't know where they're located, but you're applying a product to manage them. So this is one way that you can be sure you're following label instructions and treating the particular pest. Now, another thing that can result from this type of monitoring is the identification of new threats. This tick, the Asian longhorn tick, was first recognized in 2010, but last year really made a huge boom and huge media presence. It's been found in Westchester, Rockland, Suffolk, Staten Island, and then about 13 other states. It's an introduced tick species from Asia, as the name implies. We don't know what the risk of this tick is yet. We don't know if it's carrying any pathogens here in the United States. We don't know if it's affecting livestock or people. What we do know is that the female is parthenogenic, which means that she can reproduce, she can create offspring without sexual reproduction. That is terrifying. Imagine dropping off a single tick in different areas. She could start her own colony without reproduction. So that's why this tick is seeing such a huge boom in its population. Okay, so in terms of management, I like to break this down into things that I could do to protect myself, pets, habitat management, and then managing the hosts of the ticks. If we can avoid tick bites, then we can avoid tick-borne disease. In terms of personal protection, there are things that we can do before we go out into an area where there are ticks. There are things that we can do while we're out and then afterwards, all to prevent exposure to ticks and tick-borne disease. So, beforehand, there are products that contain a chemical called permethrin. And this is actually a tick-killing product. It's an acaricide. And it can be applied to your clothing and gear. So that includes not just the clothes that you wear, but your backpack, your camping gear, if you have such items. there are different options for treating your clothing. You can do it yourself, as seen here. These products are available over the counter at big box stores. You follow the label to treat clothing when you're not wearing it. It's really important that clothing is not being worn when this is applied. There's a higher risk of exposure when the product is wet, so clothing must be treated off of your body. When you are doing it yourself and using these products, it's estimated that it will last for about 7 washes. Okay, so the clothing has protection against ticks for about 7 washes. This product will break down over time based on exposure to sunlight, moisture, and other things. So it binds to the clothing, but after 7 washes, it is removed. There are also options where items can be pre-treated, and you can purchase clothing that has been pre-treated by one of these brands on the left, or you can send out your favorite items to be treated by this Insect Shield company, where they'll treat your personal items and then ship them back. When you have this type of service where it's being treated by one of these companies, it's expected to have a lifetime of 70 washes. So it's a much longer lifespan of that product on your clothing. Of course, it's going to cost you more, but it's a longer effect. And what's the outcome? Well, there was a study done at the University of Rhode Island where they gave people shorts, a t-shirt, sneakers, and a pair of socks that had been treated with permethrin. And then, this is obviously grad students, they put tons of ticks on them. And these are lab-reared ticks, so they're not carrying any pathogens, I hope. And then they recorded where they attached to the students. And you can see when there was no treatment, ticks were attaching everywhere in huge numbers, okay? When they had treated outfits, and this is just shorts and a t-shirt, so it's not like you're wearing your full outdoor gear. They had fewer ticks attached overall, there was a lot of mortality, and they found them mostly on legs and arms. When I look at this picture, I think those areas are really easy to inspect in the mirror. So if I'm treating my clothing, identifying a tick that I missed, that didn't die as it crawled up my clothing, is going to be a lot easier. Okay, so it makes the inspection process easier. Beforehand too, if I'm going out to an area where I know I might be exposed, when I come home, I want to make sure my clothing is isolated from the general laundry. I don't want to be putting clothing that may have a crawling tick on it in with the laundry that's going to sit in my bedroom for a couple days. So what I would do is have an area outside or maybe a clean zone when I walk inside with a plastic bag where I can dump my outdoor clothing into that bag, zip it up, and then keep it until I'm ready to wash that clothing. This way I know it's isolated. I'm not going to expose myself or anyone else in the home to ticks. Of course, this message, you guys have all heard, this is nothing new. You can have your hiker chic outfit where you tuck your pants into your socks, you know, super cool. Wear light clothing so you can see it. I don't know many people that follow these recommendations for being exposed to ticks, but this is the best way to early detect a tick that's crawling on you, having your pants tucked into your socks and your shirt tucked into your pants. Okay, now, repellents. These are different than the permethrin that I mentioned. Repellent products work by repelling ticks, okay? And the philosophy is that the tick has a harder time smelling you when you come by. Okay, they're not actively killing ticks, and they're not protecting you in any other way than making you more difficult to see. Not all products are created equally. There are 4 active ingredients that have been shown to be effective at repelling ticks as well as mosquitoes, and this includes primarily products with DEET 20-30% or picaridin at 20%. The percentage is a representation of how long that product is going to be effective at repelling ticks. So anything that is above 30 has been shown to have the same repellent efficacy as 20-30%. So the deep woods off that's, you know, 100% DEET hasn't been shown to be any more effective in a 4-5 hour range than the 20-30% DEET. There are other products, such as ones that have IR3535. This is some of the Skin So Soft brand, but not all Skin So Soft have this product. And then oil of lemon eucalyptus as well has been shown to be effective as a repellent. Obvious again, but since we know that ticks are doing this questing behavior, waiting for you to walk by, if you can avoid them by staying on a trail or staying in an area where there's less vegetation, that's one way to avoid ticks. Okay, when you're out and about, I always carry a plastic vial in my hiking bag that has alcohol. I see a tick on me, I grab it, drop it in there, kill it, and move on. Okay, so something to keep in mind if you have a truck, maybe you can have a vial handy. When I get home, whether I've stored my stuff in a plastic bag or if I'm just going to wash it right away, the really important step here is to dry those items. Okay? We want to get the temperature in that dryer to 125 degrees to kill ticks. Hot laundering in water is not effective to kill ticks. This step of drying is effective. Okay, another question. Most people can feel a tick crawling on them and the bite. False, okay? Now, I bring this one up because when I asked some of my friends on Facebook why they don't check themselves for ticks, they said, oh, well, I'd feel the bite. No, you wouldn't. This thing has adapted for millions of years to be a cryptic predator. It's adapted to crawl on you and bite you so you don't feel it. It has a number of properties in its saliva that are anesthetic and allow blood flow. So you're not going to feel it. And you're not going to feel it crawling on you. So this makes it super important for you to do daily tick checks. Okay? This should be part of your routine all year, especially for this group. If you're outside all year, you should be checking yourself for ticks every single day. How many people are checking themselves for ticks every single day? Hey, awesome. That's great. That's why this group has a very low incidence of Lyme disease, because you're checking yourself for ticks. Great. So there are certain areas where ticks are really attracted to. This is those warm and moist areas you see in the cartoon in the armpit, also the groin, belly button, base of the hairline, behind the ears and behind the knees. So all of these areas are very attractive to ticks, and that's where you should focus your inspection. But basically, you want to know every single freckle that's on your body, and if you see one with legs, that's a tick. You know, if you forget, they have these toilet cards. You could be sitting in the John instead of playing games on your phone. You can check yourself for ticks in those key areas. Ticks. Once they get on us, they are looking to feed. And so attachment is actually reinforced with cement. That's why it's so difficult to remove a tick. And as I said, their saliva prevents pain, clotting, and an immune reaction so that you are unaware of their attachment. And this is what they're actually using to pierce your skin. This is super magnified. You can see that serrated blade here that pierces your skin. They can attach in 10 to 30 minutes, but may crawl around on your body for up to 2 hours before they find that sweet spot. That is a long time. That's a lot of opportunity for you to find that tick before it attaches. And once they're attached, they may stay attached for days. Okay? Isn't that kind of gross to think about? You have this thing attached to you, sucking on your blood for days? Ugh. So, obviously, if we do our tick check, we'll be removing them. When it comes to pathogens, those can be transmitted in minutes to hours after attachment. Some pathogens, like Powassan virus, can be transmitted in a matter of 15 minutes, whereas Lyme disease, it's now anticipated 11 hours or more. The sooner you find and remove a tick, the less likely you are to be exposed to a tick-borne disease. And here is the proper removal of ticks. Again, not rocket science here. Using tweezers to grab as close to the mouth parts as possible. Basically, you want to run the tweezers along your skin and then grab around the mouth parts. Okay, that's the best way to do it. using inappropriate tweezers, the flattened, you know, hair plucking tweezers like you see on the left there, not good. The reason is that if you agitate that animal, you squeeze its abdomen, if you cause it stress, it can actually regurgitate into you. And that increases your risk of exposure to tick-borne disease. So, don't burn it, don't suffocate it, don't squeeze it, and don't twist it. Just use fine-tipped forceps, like jeweler's tweezers, to grab and remove. Okay. If you do that, I always recommend keeping them on hand. The reason for keeping this is that if in a few weeks you start to feel sick, you remove a tick, you start to feel sick, you can go to your doctor and say, look, on this day I collected this tick off my body and now I'm feeling like crap. I think I might have a tick-borne disease. This really increases your likelihood of getting the proper treatment. If your doctor isn't aware of tick-borne disease and you have to advocate for getting some kind of treatment, you may miss that treatment window and make things more complicated. If you wanted to know all the disease symptoms, there's this great resource by the CDC, but basically flu-like symptoms. I know that's really generic and really hard to pin down, but if it's the middle of the summer and you've got flu-like symptoms, or late spring and you got flu-like symptoms with fever, chills, aches, and fatigue, then maybe tick-borne. It's now estimated that only 10 to 40% of people will get that classic bullseye rash, so you cannot rely on that as a diagnostic for tick-borne disease, especially since there's so many other pathogens that are out there. Okay, also important is pet protection. If you have pets, especially animals that are outside, you should be treating them year-round. A lot of people think in the wintertime, I don't have to worry about treating my pet. This is inaccurate because we know that ticks are active year-round. We also know that things like fleas are active year-round, and if we don't protect our pets all year, then we can lead to other infestations of different pests. So, take care of your pets. For habitat management, remember, when it comes to the black-legged tick, we're considering those moist environments where there's vegetation 1.5 feet and below. So if we recognize this as tick habitat, we can either help people avoid it by doing some sort of management in that area, or we can eliminate it. This type of vegetation on the left is obvious. We have deer present, it's the right height, and it's probably nice and moist. What's the issue with the stone wall? Why would that be attractive or a good reason that ticks would be present? Warm? Did I hear mice? Okay. So this is essentially a rodent condominium complex. There are nooks and crannies for them to hang out inside that stone wall. So if we have the hosts, we can have the ectoparasites. Also, oftentimes, you know, as you see here, that wall is a barrier between a wooded area and a managed landscape. And so that's sort of the end of the tick zone, and that's where those rodents may be found. In terms of pruning, this goes against some of the horticultural recommendations, but things we can do to make the area under these plants less conducive is to open them up on the bottom. This dries out the area where ticks are going to be found and is only applicable for certain plants. Obviously, you can't do this in all horticultural settings. We have found ticks in Pachycandra right next to residential homes. So even though they're not going to be found in the lawn, if we have this conducive environment immediately adjacent to the home that has moisture and could be potential rodent harborage, then ticks can be present. So keep this in mind for either personal landscapes or landscapes here on campus. Now, there are certain plants that actually concentrate tick populations. Many of you have probably heard this story already, but Japanese barberry, used as an ornamental but is now highly recognized as an invasive species, this one really concentrates tick populations. There's some reasons why it might be. First is the leaf size and the leaf litter that's created under these plants is probably maintains the perfect moisture content for ticks. Also, wild populations are producing berries, which are great for those small mammals and rodents. And so what research has shown is that in areas where no barberry was previously found, when they sampled a defined hectare, they found 30 ticks per hectare. Okay, this is in Connecticut. That might be expected for a wooded area. When barberry was previously present but then removed, they found 121 ticks in the same area. And when it was an active barberry stand like this, they found over 251 ticks in the same amount of area. So think of that factor, from 30 to 251, just by having this one plant. So obviously, it's a great reason to manage invasive species populations such as this. Now, I realize this is, again, a residential setting. This may apply to your home, but it can also apply to here on campus, where we want to think about the areas where ticks are present and how we can set natural borders to prevent people from going into tick zones, and also where activity is limited in those tick zones. The main point is communicated here is to set up some sort of buffer between areas where ticks are present. So in this case, they have a stone wall, they have a mulch barrier, and then they have another 3-yard barrier of vegetation or turf before they put the things that people are going to be using, like in this case, the swing set and the garden. If that's possible here, that would be great. It's all about assessing the property and determining where it might be possible to limit people's interaction with tick habitat. Some other recommendations. I'll first highlight the ones on the bottom. These are not based on rigorous scientific studies. They're based on common sense approaches to limiting rodents and ticks in that area. So bird feeders that are in areas where people are active, birds are also hosts of ticks. So a bird can fly into the bird feeder and a tick could drop off. So if we want to keep them away from the home. Fruit-bearing landscape plants are attractive to those small mammals and rodents, so keeping them away from the structure as well. And then there are numerous considerations for mowing height that are ideal for the turf, but also allow it to be less attractive to those black-legged ticks. Maximize sunlight and play areas. So again, we're just trying to avoid those conducive conditions that are present for the black-legged tick. There is a really handy resource that you can download for free. This is Tick Management Options, created by the Public Tick IPM Working Group. I won't go into the discussion here, but this provides a lot of the treatment recommendations that you may use as an applicator. Now, there are some approaches that will target the hosts of ticks. This tick box is one of them. Has anybody used this? Has anybody heard of it? You've used it. Okay, excellent. So some people are aware of this. How this works is it's a rodent feeding station. Rodents enter the station to get some kind of bait. It's a non-toxic bait. It's just to feed them. And as they pass through, they expose themselves to this wick that has fipronil. And that's the same product that's used in Frontline. What it does is it actually treats the mice to kill any ticks that are on their bodies. This interrupts the transmission cycle to ticks. So if there's no transmission to the tick themselves, then the risk of them biting a human or other animal and transmitting the pathogen is reduced. With this particular system, you actually have to be certified by the manufacturer, and it's really expensive from what I understand. Each box is very expensive, so to set up a program for a university would be out of the question, but there may be certain applications. Another useful technique is exclusion of deer. Now, this isn't going to be 100% effective, but if there's certain high value areas where you can keep the deer out, this will minimize the migration of ticks, but it won't eliminate it. Remember that the small mammals can also host the ticks and birds can move them as well. So this isn't 100% fix, but it may be useful. And I know here that there's a huge deer population. The technique that is most effective at killing ticks is acaricide applications. These should be timed and targeted to when ticks are actively questing. So based on what you've learned today, would you think that it's more important to treat in the spring, summer, or fall? Spring, okay. So we have here May to June, and also October, spring and fall. But based on people's exposure, it's usually to that nymphal tick. So if we can apply in the spring, that's often the best time. We want to apply in areas where we've sampled for ticks and identified that ticks are present. So generally not all over the place. Usually it ends up being these border areas between the managed landscape and the woods. There are certain considerations for these applications, okay? Obviously, we're going to follow the label, but some of the research has shown that the high-pressure spray rigs are the most effective because these agitate the leaf litter and vegetation enough to actually contact and kill the ticks. A lot of the other applications don't get enough active ingredient to those ticks to be effective. The best products that have been shown to date continue to be the pyrethroids, such as products that contain these active ingredients. But remember, there are considerations about water, pollinators, and rain when it comes to the pyrethroids. There's often a question about essential oils and how effective they are at controlling ticks. The first thing is that there's a lack of efficacy data when it comes to essential oil products. This is because there's no registration requirement for these products, and so they don't have to prove that they're going to be effective before they go to market. It has been shown that direct contact can kill ticks, but there's no longevity to that treatment. Once the product is applied, if you don't kill the ticks on contact, that's it, that you missed your window. So monitoring is still needed for these programs to document what's the population beforehand and afterwards to show that they've been effective. Okay, and the last true-false question, killing ticks at home reduces your risk of Lyme disease. What do you think? Okay, unfortunately, again, bearing bad news, even though we know that applications of acaricides kill ticks on properties, it's been shown that this does not reduce the risk of Lyme disease on properties. And the mechanism for this is that people are exposed to ticks in other areas than just their property. So you go hiking, you could pick up a tick. You go to your neighbor's house who didn't get this treatment and you can pick up a tick. There are a number of places that ticks can be found. So yes, this may help reduce your tick population, but may not reduce your exposure to tick-borne disease. Now there are studies that are actively going right now, one in the Hudson Valley at the Carey Institute, one in Connecticut, and one at Maryland, that are all looking at this integrated tick management and taking a neighborhood approach. So they're treating entire neighborhoods with these different types of treatments. One is using the tick control box that I mentioned. The other is using this product called MET52, which is a fungal pathogen. This is what it does to ticks. Also very satisfying to see something like that, knowing they suffered and died. So these are just sort of in their infancy, these products. I think the Carey Institute project is this one here, the tick project. It's in its second or third of 5 years. They're looking at a whole number of variables, not just does it kill ticks and reduce tick populations, but how does it affect everyone in the home, including pets? Did even pets get exposed to tick-borne disease? So as we learn more, we'll report back on how effective these area-wide controls are. So in summary, avoid and/or reduce tick habitat. If you have the option to do that, that's great. Only treat the areas where ticks are found. Check yourself daily for ticks. I applaud you already for doing that. And seriously, consider surveillance. It's real cheap and easy to make these types of drag cloths, and you can document where ticks are present. I will just mention a few things about our educational campaign. So we have the Don't Get Tick New York campaign. Education is essential, as I said. This was what I asked people, why are you not checking yourself for ticks? And people had a number of interesting responses. My favorite is, I'm too hairy. So obviously you can't check yourself for ticks. But you know, this checking yourself for ticks daily and making sure that your family members are doing it is essential. We have some resources to help people, motivate people to do that. We have a cool claymation video on our website that talks about the biology of the black-legged tick. We have an FAQ, infographics that I'll show you real quick. Hopefully you picked up your tick identification card today. They're available in English and Spanish. And here are our infographics. So there's 10 of these that are free for download. And they basically have a single message that will help you to avoid or manage ticks. So doing a daily tick check, selecting an appropriate... that one's not here. We have one for repellents. This one is for clothing treatments. And then how to make that tick drag. Okay. Let's skip that one. And... I guess that's it. Thank you.
This has been a production of Cornell University on the web at cornell.edu.